this video, we're going to cover all the things you need to know before you get started contributing to the Qiskit repos. Maybe you are familiar now with the basics of Git and GitHub, and you want to start doing more complicated things like adding code to the actual Qiskit repos. In this video, we're going to cover everything you need before you actually make that first commit. So first of all, let's talk about all the different ways that there are to make a contribution to Qiskit. There are many different things that you can do to support the Qiskit open source community. There are some things that are smaller amounts of effort, some things that are greater amounts of effort. So whatever your personal circumstances are and how much time you have on your hands, there is something that you can get involved in. The first thing, and one of the most useful contributions that you can make, is if you are an active user of Qiskit and you find a bug in the Qiskit code, please tell us about it. Please report any bugs that you find. You can do this by going to the Qiskit GitHub repo where you found the bug and open an issue and call it bug report. Similarly, if you're a user of Qiskit and maybe there is a feature that you think is missing or something that you would like to see, you can also open an issue to request a feature. If you want to go a step beyond just opening issues, you can also have a look through the other issues that are open as well and maybe choose one to work on yourself, or even just leave comments on them. If there's something in particular that you have some extra information that you can add, an extra example of a bug working on your machine, go ahead and add those to the issue. That really helps add more context to what is happening. As well as that, if you see any pull requests from other members of the community, you can also help to review those pull requests as well. If you just generally want to get involved with discussions around Qiskit, we do have a feedback repo in the Qiskit organization where you can go and join in different discussions on various topics, as well as, of course, our Slack community and Twitter as well. People also often in those forums ask questions, as well as on Stack Exchange as well, that reference Qiskit. So if you can help other users to fix their problems, or if they don't know how to do something and you can help them, definitely go ahead and comment on those questions to help out other users. If you want to take a more active involvement in the things that we do in developing Qiskit, you can attend our Qiskit demo days and our Qiskit office hours. We'll leave links in the descriptions there for where you can find out more information about those. And lastly, maybe if you have done a lot of development work on your own and you've developed a project that uses Qiskit or that expands Qiskit, you can open source it yourself and then apply to have that project join the Qiskit ecosystem. We'll also leave links in the description about that as well. So now that you have a bit of a general idea of what kind of things you can contribute, what you're going to want to do is head over to the Qiskit GitHub organization, where you will find a lot of different repositories to explore and find some things that you might want to get involved in. I've just highlighted very few here. Qiskit Terra is essentially the core capabilities of Qiskit. That's the largest repo. There's the most activity going on there. It's Python-based. There's also the Qiskit Applications repos. This has got themes around quantum chemistry, finance, machine learning. So if you are a domain specialist in one of those areas, you might want to go to some of those repos. If you're not so much of a Python developer, there are still other repositories that you can contribute to. Qiskit Air is developed with C++. This is our simulator module. And we also have quite a few repositories that focus on more front-end frameworks, particularly the Vue framework. So these are the Qiskit.org repo, which helps to produce the Qiskit website, as well as Platypus, which is all of the development work that goes into the Qiskit textbook. So there are a ton of different things to get involved in. It might be a bit overwhelming at first. So I really recommend the first thing you do if you're considering contributing, just kind of familiarize yourself with all the different repositories that are going on in this organization. So now let's say you've selected a repo that you want to get involved in. Then what you're going to want to do is in that repository, let's say, for example, it's Qiskit Terra, that you're going to want to go to the Issues tab here. And here you will see a lot of open issues, particularly if you're looking in Terra. We have, you know, hundreds of issues open at any one time that are all waiting for developers to jump in on and start working on. If this is your first time contributing to that repo, the best thing to do is to filter these issues by good first issue. You can also filter by help wanted. This is for issues that maybe are a little bit more advanced than a good first issue, but still ones that we are encouraging members of the community to get involved in. You can also go to the milestones tab on this side in the GitHub repository, which will take you to a list of what's coming up in the future planned releases of Qiskit. And you can therefore get an idea for what features are a priority and keep an eye on how that is going. One thing to note is if you are considering getting involved and working on any of these issues, look for issues that have not already been assigned to someone else, because someone else might already be working on those. Next up, before you start doing any code, what you're going to want to do is read the contributing guidelines. Every open source repo should have a contributing guidelines. That's not just a Qiskit specific thing, just anyone who's in open source, it's good practice to have one. So every Qiskit repo does have a contributing guidelines. And this is essentially a document which explains to outside community members how they can most effectively get involved in contributing to that repository. Even though there are a lot of repos within Qiskit, don't assume that the contributing guidelines are going to be the same for every single Qiskit repo. They are similar to a certain extent. They do share some conventions, but ultimately, you know, the specifics of that repo can dictate any kind of changes that you might need to make when you're contributing. And if you're stuck, make sure to refer to the guidelines first. It's probably quicker than trying to ask someone on the maintainer team. And a lot of the time, what the maintainers will do will anyway share links back to the contributing guidelines. It helps you kind of not waste maintainers' time and not waste your own time. It's pretty quick to go and refer to the contributing guidelines. They're normally at the root of the project. So in Terra, it's kind of at the bottom here. And I know the guidelines are often very long. You don't have to remember everything the first time you read them, but it's good to just make sure that you know where it is. So if you do get stuck or you're not sure how to do something when you're contributing, you can refer back to it and use it as a reference guide. And a lot of the things that we cover in this series around GitHub and open source contributions are likely already covered in the contributing guidelines. So if you take one thing away from what I'm telling you, it's make sure you know where the contributing guidelines are and make sure you know what's in it. And lastly, but possibly most importantly, is be kind to others when you are getting involved in open source. This is not just true for us, it's true for any open source repository you might be wanting to contribute to. On the Qiskit team, we really care about making sure the community is a welcoming place for others, so we do have a code of conduct that we actively enforce. Most of it is just common sense. Be kind to others. Be aware that there is a real human on the other end of your comments or your messages. And if you yourself are unfortunately have a negative experience in one way or another, you can refer to the code of conduct to see what you can do to address those issues. Okay, that's it for this video. Thank you very much for watching.